Hey you guys, Guy Stevens here. I've had a few comments about people who said that some of my videos are going a little bit too fast for them. So I wanted to make a very simple, very basic video on how to work with FileMaker, the absolute beginner basics for people who have no idea what FileMaker is or does or how it works. So this is the file we're gonna make, a very simple one, a very simple contacts database where we will have a ability to enter a bunch of contacts information, the ability to kind of make some, to just add a bunch of information, add a little picture, a little to-do list for things that we need to do for this contact, a map that kind of shows us where this contact lives, and a website tab for if this person has a website, we can see that website straight away right in here. And also a contact section here where we can again see our to-do notes in a slightly different type of list. And we're also going to be learning a little bit about how to create a relationship between two different tables, and we're going to be learning a little bit about how to create little scripts. So a whole bunch of stuff we're going to learn, but very simple and very basic. So let's get started. So if you open up FileMaker, you'll get something like this, and what we're going to do is we're going to make a new solution. We're just going to make one from scratch. So if you do that, you're going to have to look for some sort of a place to save your file. And let's call this one basics. Okay, if you do that, then we've started a file and there is some stuff that pops up here right from the start. Like for instance, this is a field picker, which we don't really need right now, but let's just leave it there. Okay, what we're gonna do is we're gonna make a very simple file where we're gonna store some contact information and we're gonna make some notes and make some to-do notes. So to begin with any FileMaker file, what we're gonna do is we're gonna go to File, Manage, and then Database. This is where we do basically all of our database management stuff. So we get this little pop-up box that has three tabs on the front here. You've got tables, fields, and relationships. So a table, if we see here, we see that we already have a table called basics, and that's because my file name is called is named basics. FileMaker does that automatically. Now in this case, that's not really handy because that's not very useful to me. If I go to the fields, then I can see that I have my table basics. And if I go into my relationships, I can see that a box here has already been made for my basics. But I don't want that one because I don't like that name. So I'm going to delete this one. And then FileMaker is going to ask me if I want to permanently delete the FileMaker table and all the fields and record data, but it's going to also ask me if I also want to remove the occurrences of these tables in the graph. Now the graph is the relationships graph, which we see in here. There was a little box there. I don't want that one, so delete everything so that I have a very clean new file to begin with. Now I said I was going to make a contacts database, so let's make a table called contacts. So we can enter the name right here, and then we can click create, and there we have created our first table. Now, if we think about a contact database, we're gonna wanna store people's name, people's address, people's phone number, and email address, and stuff like that. And those things would be fields. So in our table of contacts, we're gonna make a certain amount of fields. So let's click on the fields, and we can see that this table is still completely empty. Now, a golden rule in any database is that you should always start with an ID field so that every contact can have his own unique ID number so that you can refer to those contacts later on. You could also refer to contacts by their name, but if you have two people with the same name, then you have a problem. Also, if you enter someone's name and then later on you find out that you've entered the name wrong and you have to change it, then if you're using that name as the basis for a relationship, that relationship will be broken. So always make an ID field, and so here you can type your a field name. You can put in a comment if you want to remind you what that field is about. So this is to uniquely identify each contact. Now I don't normally make a lot of comments, only in the case of very special fields, but because we're doing a beginner course, let's just try all of these things out. So this is going to be a number field because I want all every single contact to get a unique number. So I'm going to create this, and now the difficulty is going to be, well, what number should I give every contact, and what if I accidentally use the same number twice? Well, to prevent that from happening, we're going to let FileMaker give out these numbers itself. And it's going to do that in a way that it never uses the same number twice. So if I double click on this field, I'm going to get field options for my ID field. And I've got an auto enter tab right here, which is kind of good because this will automatically enter the following data into this field. Now I would like to have a unique number, and that would be a serial number. So I want this to be generated on the creation of this record. So every time I make a new contact, I would like to make a new serial number for this contact. So it's going to start on the number one, and it's going to increment by one. So my first contact is going to be number one, the second one is going to be two, and so on and so on. Okay, so that's pretty good. There's a lot of other stuff here, but we're not going to deal with that stuff right now. So let's hit OK, and we've got our first field, an auto enter serial field. Now what we can do here is we can go in here and make a new field. Now when we make contacts, we are going to want to store their name. And if we're going to store a name, we have to ask ourselves, how are we going to store that name? Are we going to do the first name and the last name separately, or are we going to do them together? Well, if we put the first and the last name together, and we want to maybe sort by last name, then we won't be able to do that because the last name is in the same field as the first name. So we will only be able to sort then on the first name. If we write first name first and last name then after. You could also enter, write down the last name first and then the first name. So like if you have a person named John Doe, you could write in Doe John, and then you can sort by last name, but then you can't sort by first name if you'd ever want to. Also, if you would like to make a letter that says Dear Mr. Doe, then you can't do that because that last name is in the same field as the first name. So a good rule of thumb is to always separate all of your data into the smallest possible piece. So first name and last name would be in two different fields. So I'm going to say first name. And then my type is of course not going to be a number because the first name is a text. So let's use text here. And then this is this needs to be a different comment because this comment doesn't apply to this field. So I'm going to get rid of this comment and I'm going to hit create. So now I've made a second field, first name. Of course, when I have a first name, I also need to have a last name. And that's also a text field. Okay, this is looking pretty good. What else do I need? Let's say I would like an address. Okay, that's pretty good. An address is also a text, so that's good. I can add that one. Then an address is going to be like the street name plus the number, so I could create a separate field for the number, but I don't think in this case it's really necessary. The address is usually street name plus number, so let's leave that together. And then let's say a zip code. And as you can see, I usually prefer to not use any spaces, so I'll just use a capital at the beginning of each word. And then a zip code, that really depends on the country. Like in my country, that would be just a number, but in some countries they use letters as well. So I think I'll just keep this as a text just to be sure, because if this is a text, I can enter numbers and letters. So that's a pretty good idea to leave it like that. So a zip code, I will need a city as well, which is also a text. What else could I get? If I want to contact this person, I might want to have their email address, and an email address is also going to be a text. So that's good. I might want to have a phone field. Now a phone number could be all letters, but you're going to use slashes, and maybe you're going to put in a country code as well. So I think I'll just leave this one as text. That is good. You could use a number, but in general I think you should use numbers Like for instance, a phone number is not something that you're going to use in a calculation anyway. So it doesn't really matter if it's a number or a text field. And just to be safe, I think I'll keep this as a text. If I'm going to enter a number, then I would definitely use the number type field, especially if I want to use that number in like a calculation or something like that. Phone, what else do I have? Let's say that I want to maybe write some remarks about a certain person. So let's add that field as well. Okay, this is looking pretty good, I think, as a beginning. So I think we can get started with this. Okay, let's hit OK and let's see what we have. So now what happens is we basically have nothing here and we arrive in our layout for basics. Now, if you remember, that was a table and also a layout that FileMaker created for me automatically. But I don't want that one because it makes no sense. So I'm going to go to File and I'm going to go to Manage and I'm going to manage my layouts, because this is a layout we're looking at right now. And now I can see that FileMaker has got two layouts for me. My contacts was probably going to be a good one because I just created that table. But this basics, this makes no sense. And it also does not even have an associated table anymore because that table has already been deleted. So I'm going to delete this layout. Yep, and I don't want it. And then my contacts layout automatically pops up. And we can see that it already has a bunch of fields on it, which is pretty cool. So I'm going to close this field picker for now because I don't need it. And I'm going to exit this layout just so that I can have a look at what I've got going on right here. So this looks pretty cool. I would like to make a contact. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to click in here and then I get an error message that tells me there are no records present. To create a new record, choose the new record menu command. Okay, what is the new record menu command? Well, you can see it up top here. This is a one of the buttons in your top bar right here. And these are all the buttons that you're going to be using to kind of navigate through your FileMaker file, kind of. So the new record is very simple. If we click it, it adds a new empty record. And now we can see that we have one single record here. The ID has been entered automatically. So that's number one. I'm going to go in here and I'm going to say, let's create a John and let's create a John Snow. Okay, I can enter all of these things as well. Let's see, Church Road 25 or something, doesn't really matter. 90210, Beverly Hills. Email is john@snoo.com and whatever. This is a number, and then this is a cool guy. Okay, so now this is kind of cool and this is kind of handy, but there is this one little thing that I usually like to do when I make a file. I always like to have the ability to go and look at my data in a table view. And if you see here, you get like three different kinds of views. You get a form view, that is the one that we're looking at right now. And that is a very good view to be able to enter data. For any user who wants to use this file, they're going to be entering data like this. Then you also have a list view that you can use to list multiple contacts in this case. And you have a table view. Now, if you click on this one, what we get is the kind of view that you would get in like an Excel type of sheet. And this is a very handy view if you want to look at stuff, look at data, and if you want to manipulate some data maybe, or look stuff up. So a table view is extremely handy, especially to manipulate large amounts of records. But the form view is very handy to fill in information. But what I usually like to do is I like to keep those two separate, because I don't have any of those fields right now. But I'll I'll give you an example here. Let's say that if we add a field by going to File, Manage Database, let's add gender, and that would be a text field if we create that one. Okay, and we add it to our layout. Let's go into Edit Layout, then we get a new top bar here. And we're going to use the fields tool right here. And we're going to drag this field down here. Let's put it somewhere here in the bottom. And then we're going to add our gender field. And we're going to check the box to create a label. Okay, like if we add this one, then we could enter mail, which is cool. But we could also edit this and let's see, we have to make our view, our inspector visible. Oh, looks like he's already visible. Where is he then? He's hidden. Oh yeah, he's on my other screen there. Okay, my inspector was kind of hidden up here. Okay. What we can do is change this field a little bit. If we go to the data tab right here, we can say that we want this field to be a little bit simpler. I don't want to manually type something in here. I want this to be a radio button set. And I want to get the values from a new value list called gender. And I want to use male and female. Okay, okay, that's great. Now the problem with this is if I go into my table view and I modify this one to add plus add my gender field, what it does is, because this is based on the same because this is on the same layout, I've got this one layout where in my form view I've created this radio button set. If I go into the table view here, I also get this this radio button set in here, and I find that to be kind of annoying, because what if I, let's say I am in my form view here, let's edit my layout, let's say that I want to add my gender field again, and I want to exit my layout, and instead of writing male, I'm gonna write whoopsie. There. So if I now want to find everyone who is male, I will find nobody. And if I go into my table view to try and find out what's going on, whoops. Let's go back here. Let's get rid of this one again. So my gender field is here. If I go in tab view, so then I kind of see my field here, I can see that neither of these two values is selected, but I know that there is another value in that field. I just can't see it because my view here is kind of obstructed by this set of radio buttons. And I never like to have that kind of stuff in my table view because it obstructs my view of my actual data. Now if I, let's see, if I make a new record and in that new record I click male, then that's good. I've got one male and one of these is like iffy. So I always like to keep these two things separate because on my form view, I do like to have the ability to have these kinds of radio buttons and drop downs and checkboxes and all of that. But I don't want that to obscure my view in my table view. So what I always like to do is I always create two different layouts. One of those layouts I keep in table view and one of those layouts I keep in form view. So let's go ahead and do that and split those two up, and then I will show you what's happening with my fields. So if we go into layout mode, which was the button here, then we can create a new layout. And I always like to call these ones lay for layout. And what did I have? Contacts. There you go. Layout contacts. And this is going to be for my computer. This one is going to be in form view and is going to be based on my contacts table. So that's good. I'm going to finish that. And now I am kind of stuck with an empty one. That's kind of annoying because in the previous one I already had all my fields. This one I do not. But we did have, when you go to view, we did have our handy field picker that we can use to kind of do to kind of add fields. Now I can Command Alt to get all of my fields, but actually, to be truly honest, there are a few fields, or at least there's one field that I don't really need to see. I don't really want my user who's just entering data to deal with the ID. I also don't want my user to be able to accidentally change this ID because that could create a problem. So I'm gonna not put my ID field on this layout, and let's look at all the other ones. The other ones all look kind of good, so let's drag these on here. Let's, because I can also choose like at the bottom here, the field placement and all that, but that's looking good. Let's see, let's drop them down here, and that's looking pretty good if you ask me. So I'm done with my field picker. I'm gonna exit my layout and let's have a look. I'm gonna go back to my previous record and I've got all my data in here. So that's kind of cool. So now I need to go back in my layout mode to kind of fix this one up again. In my data view here, I had this one set up as a radio button set, and the values we were using were the values gender. So now I fixed this one again. That's kind of good. And now I will show you the difference. So now if we go here, we see that we have our layout of the contacts and we have our original contacts layout, but I'm gonna put this one in table view and I still have this problem going on here, so I don't really want this here. So what I'm gonna do is in my form view, I'm gonna edit my layout and I'm gonna make sure that this one is no longer a radio button set, but a simple edit box. Okay, that seemed like a very long and complicated explanation, but the idea is if I keep this one in table view, then I can see that I've made a mistake in this one somehow, maybe because of a script, maybe because of some reason, some incorrect value has been entered here. And here in this view, I can see that incorrect value, whereas on my layout, I cannot. But of course, when I check a box here, that kind of fixes it because that puts the correct value in that field. Let's go and have a look here and see, now it's kind of fixed. But in this kind of table view, you can often find mistakes that are maybe not visible in your layout. Right there. And what I always like to do is I like to keep this a little bit organized because now it's a bit confusing. So let's go to File, Manage Layouts. And let's organize this stuff. So if I deselect everything, then I've got this little arrow here and I can create a new folder. And I like to have one for my tables. And I like to have one for my layouts. There we go. So this one is obviously going to be in table view. So let's drag this one and put it here. If you drag kind of left and right, you can see that it kind of goes in or not in that folder. So let's put it in this folder. And this one is going to be a layout. So this needs to be in my layouts folder. So great. Now I've got one layout and one layout in table view. So that's very cool. I can very easily kind of go back and forth and kind of really look at what my data is doing here. And then in this one, I can just have my user enter some data in here. Okay, first step. We've created our a nice, cute little layout. So that's kind of good. What are we going to do now? Okay, so I haven't never really finished explaining you that whole top bar. So I'll just do that. So the first one here you have is like, I'll just put a name in here, Edgar, whatever, Hoover, okay. So if you can see, you can use these arrows to kind of move from the one contact to the next contact. That's pretty handy. And we can see that we have a total of two records, and a record in this case is a contact. If it's not clear where we are, what we can do is we can just put a title in the top here, contacts, and let's make that nice and big. How do I make it nice and big? Well, there's a little button here with two A's that can show or hide the formatting bar. It's always hidden in the beginning, so you always have to kind of get it there. And then you can change the font and all of that stuff. I'm gonna line it up like this on the side. There you go. I'm in my contacts. Cool. So I'm browsing through my contacts right now. That's kind of cool. I have two, and if I want to make a new one, I can do that, and I could say Judy, I don't know, Styles, whatever, and she's a female. Okay, so I can make a new record, and a record in this case is a contact, or I can delete a contact. If I make a new one, and it's Joe, oh, no, that's a mistake, and I want this one, I can delete this one again. Are you sure you want to delete this one? Yep, I am sure. Now I can find something as well, but there is also a search here. So what's the difference between find and search? Well, very simple. The find, if you click that one, you'll get a minor heart attack because you'll all of a sudden see that all my values are gone. But actually they are not gone. What this find allows you to do is it allows you to search in a specific field. So I can search for everyone who is male, for instance. And if I perform that find, then I have found 2 out of 3 total, because if you remember, we made 1 female. And of course, that female has not been found. We have found only the male ones. So if we browse through these 2 that we've got, we can see that this one is male, the previous one is also male, and the next one here, it's some kind of going back and forth. But if I want to go further or backwards, there are only 2 records. There's nothing more. Now, this is kind of a problem, because where is my female? Well, she is still there. I do still have a total of 3 records, but she's kind of hidden right now because I was looking for all the males. If I want to see all of my records again, very simple, there is a show all button. And if I click this button, keep an eye on this here, it kind of goes back to showing all 3. And now I can get back to my 1 female contact that I had. So that's what the find does. Now the find, if you click it, it allows you to search in 1 specific field. But if we cancel this find, the search button allows us to basically search in all of the fields. I can, for instance, look for a John, and it finds me my 1 John Snow. But I could also look for all the people that are male, and then I will find 2 records, so my 2 male records. And so I can use this one to search in any kind of field. Now, if you have a lot of fields and a lot of records, this could be a little bit slower, because it's going to look in all of the fields, and this find is going to be a little bit more specific, because you are kind of specifying in which field you would like to search. Also, sometimes there might be values that are showing up in different fields, and so this one might not be specific enough. But in some cases, if you know that you wrote down something but you don't remember in which field you wrote it down, this one can be pretty handy. Okay, sorting is very simple. You can sort by, like, say, the last name, for instance, and then you can sort ascending or descending, and then you can sort, and then your records are sorted. If we show them all, we will see that we've got Snow, Hoover, and Styles. Let's see, is that stored? Sort, okay. Let's sort again, because maybe... Oh yeah, no, it's Hoover now, and then Snow, and then Styles. It's because I did the show all that my sort kind of got lost. But that's a way that you can use to sort records. And now please do keep in mind that I can now sort either by last name or by first name, because I've put those values in different fields. And so therefore that's always kind of a handy smart thing to do, is to just keep those kind of values in separate fields. Okay, so I think that kind of explains everything here. You can browse through your records, you can show them all. If you've done a find, you can make a new one or delete one. You can do a find in a specific field, or you can do a find overall. Now, share is to upload to a FileMaker server, or to share with other FileMaker clients who are on the same network as you. And all of this stuff is if you want to collaborate with multiple people on 1 FileMaker file. These are kind of the 2 ways to do that. Okay, so this is kind of cool. Let's see if we can maybe make a few changes to make this look a little bit better. I have my remarks field, so let's put this one up here. And let's make this one a bit bigger, because maybe I want to write down a lot of remarks. Okay, if I want to write down even more remarks, I might want to go to my data tab here, and I might want to say that this is an edit box, but I also want to have a vertical scroll bar that is there kind of always, because then I can just type in as much text as I want. Okay, this is kind of cool. Now, another thing that's kind of handy is, if you're going to be filling this stuff out, you're probably going to be using your tab key to go from the 1 record to the next. So let's go to an empty one here. Let's say Judy Styles. And if I hit tab, I go from the first name, boom, to remarks. If I hit tab again, then I go to last name, address, and so forth. That doesn't look like it's ideal, because I might want to go here, and then do all of these before maybe arriving in the end with the remarks. So as the tab order is right now, it's not right. It goes from here to there to there. That's kind of stupid. If we can fix that, it's very simple. So we can go into edit layout, and we can go into layouts, and we can set the tab order. And if we do that, a bunch of arrows show up together with this little box here. And then we can see that this is the field. That is the first one. Then this is number two, and then this is number three. Now it's actually very simple to change this. You can just change these numbers. You can click on them and you can enter another number. But what's very handy as well is you can do clear all. Now they're all empty, and then you can just click in them in the order that you would like to have these be. So I'm going to click here first, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, then let's do the gender, and then let's do the remarks. Okay, so this is kind of cool. Let's hit OK, and then let's exit the layout to try this out. So I'm going to hit tab, and now my tab order is pretty cool, and it ends up there. So that's pretty cool. That's the way that you can change that thing. Okay, so because I named my my fields without any spaces, my labels are also showing up without spaces, so I might have to change a few of those, but that's not really a big problem. All right, cool. Okay, now this is cool. We have all our ways to kind of navigate through all of these records. That's kind of good. But if you have like a lot of records, then it might be a little bit difficult to find someone. You might want to get a bit of an overview. That's a little bit handier than using these kind of records. And so we haven't used this one here yet, this list view. So let's use that. What I like to do is, so because you could do this, you could click on here, but that's not even working right now. And the reason is, if you go into edit layout and we kind of edit this layout by hitting this pencil, we will see that the views that have been allowed on this layout is only form view. List view is not even allowed. Table view is also not allowed. But that's kind of good. Let's keep it like that. I think that's a good idea. Because if I'm going to make a list view, I would like to make a new layout. So let's go into edit layout. Let's make a new layout, and let's say we're going to show the records from contacts. That's good. I'm going to make a list of contacts, and this is going to be for my computer. This is going to be a list view, and that's kind of good. If we do that, we get a kind of a flat looking layout with very thin areas. This is the header, this is the body, and this is the footer. So in the body is where I'm going to put most of my stuff. So let's add some fields here, and I've got a little field tool here. I can just drag that down, and I can put it in here, and then I could choose, let's say, first name, and I've got this create label box, but if I do that, my label shows up here. I actually would like to put this up top, but if I do so, you can't really read it very well, and that is because it automatically gets a sort of style, which you can see here. It gets a default style, but it needs to be more like a header text. So you can choose to either do this, or you could just simply not create a label at all. Just take the new text tool, and if you start a new text in here and you say first name, then that one will automatically get the header text style because you're creating this text in the header. Now I'm going to put this one using my arrow keys. I'm going to put this one higher, this one a bit lower, and then I can just move this one a bit like that. Okay, that's kind of cool. So I've got my first name and I've got my label. That's kind of good. Maybe I want my header to be a little bit bigger because I'm going to be thinking ahead. I might want to put up some buttons here later. This is showing me size in centimeters, which is not handy. But if I click on the centimeter, it turns to points and even to inches. I don't want that. I want points. That's kind of good. This is 50 points high. I'm going to say give it to me in 75 points high. Yep, that's good. I'll lower this one a bit. There you go. That looks better. Let's move this over to the side a little bit, and then let's get cracking. I want the last name as well. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to select the both of these. I'm going to hit on my Mac. I'm going to hit the Alt key, and I'm going to drag these over. And there are these blue lines that show up, and I like these because I think this is lining up pretty well. I'm going to put these next to here, and then I'm going to go back until it kind of hits, and then I'm going to hit my arrow key to the right 2 times just to get a tiny little space here. Then I'm going to double click this one and I'm going to say from my contacts, I would like to see my last name. Sometimes maybe my last name is a little longer, so I will do that. Last name. Okay, good. Let's change that one. And now I can add as many fields as I want to, but I think for this example, this is already a good start. And now my body is a little bit larger here than my fields are, so I can make this one a little bit more narrow. There you go, that's kind of good. Let's exit my layout and let's have a look. Well, my list view is working because I've got all my characters here nicely listed up. So I've got Edgar, John, and Judy. I don't like this very much, where my current selected record looks different than the other ones. Maybe you do like that, but I usually like to turn that off. So I'm going to go to my layout settings here using that little pen tool, and I'm going to go to the settings here where it says delineate fields on current record only. I don't like that, so I'm going to switch this off, and if I look then all my records look the same. Okay, that's kind of cool. So I now have my list of records, and if I go back to this layout, then I've got all like my detailed information about my contact. Okay, that is good, but it would kind of be fun if I would have a simpler way to go from my list to my detailed view. So if I go to my list, I would like to be able to click on a character, person's name, and then kind of see their information. Now, there's another thing that's kind of bothering me a little bit, and that's the fact that I've got these two different fields here. Now, this is kind of cool because I can sort, for instance, by last name. So HSS, okay, or I can sort maybe by first name. Oh, and that's kind of the same sort. Let's see if we can make a new record for Zara. I don't know, Quincy, that's probably not really a last name, but this will give me a sort. Let's do this the other way around. Boom. So now I'm sorting by, I don't even remember, first name. Okay. So first name and then upside down. Okay. Let's sort by last name. Okay, cool. Okay, cool. I would like to make these things into buttons. That's one thing, so that I can just click them and then go to the detailed layout. But also, I think it's kind of annoying that the names are apart. It's a little less easy to read. So what I'm going to do is, I've told you that it's always best to split these up because it is very simple to get them back together. Let's go to File, Manage, Database, and let's figure out how we can make the first and the last name get together. And the way we're going to do that is we're going to simply make a new field. And it's kind of going to be a calculation that brings those two fields together. So if it's a calculation field or a field that does a calculation, I like to call it C underscore for calculation and then full name. Now, if it's going to do a calculation, then I would like to use the calculation type. And then I'm going to create this field. And as soon as I want to create a calculation field, FileMaker is going to ask me, well, what kind of calculation do you want to do? And then I've got all these fields from my table that I can use, and I've got all these functions here that I can use, and I've got all these operators to put in between. And what I'm going to do is very simple. I'm going to take the first name, I'm going to add a space, and then I'm going to add the last name. And very important is always to check at the bottom here, and it says right here that the calculation result is a number. But that's not really what I want right now. This is going to result in a full name, which is not a number, but a text. Very important to change that. If you don't change this now, and you're going to use this field in dropdowns later on, it's going to show you a question mark. So if you ever have a dropdown that results in a question mark or a bunch of question marks, then you've made a calculation somewhere like this, and you've left it as a number result, which is not really going to work. The specified field cannot be found. Okay, that's kind of annoying. The reason is because I've got two things going on here, and I have to use an operator if I want to use multiple types of things. And an operator like here could be an and I have to put that like in between here. So I've got first name and last name. Sounds good to me. Let's try it out. If we hit OK, I don't get an error message. I have my C-fill name. That's not good. It needs to be C-full name. I'm going to change this. Okay, C-full name, which is first name and last name. That sounds like it's good to me. Let's try it out. Let's edit the layout and let's add this field here. Let's add my full name. I don't want to create a label for this, and I'm just going to hit OK and make it a little bit wider. And let's have a look. What have I done? Oh no, this doesn't look good at all. They are stuck together. The first and last name have been stuck together. But it is kind of easy, and it does look kind of, it's already kind of cool. I've combined those two into one single field. So that's very easy to do, except that I do still have a little problem going on here. Let's try and figure out what has gone wrong. If you go to File Manage Database, and I go back into my full name field, what I've done is I've basically joined two fields together. So I've got one field here, and I've got another field there. And the thing is, I would like to get a space in between those two fields. Now, a space is going to be like a third element. I've got one field, another field, and I'm going to have to add a space. Now, if I want to add a field in here, I can just enter the name of that field. I could type it, or I can just add it by double-clicking the field right here, and it just shows up without anything. But if I want to enter some text, then what I need to do is I need to use these quotation marks. So if I use these quotation marks and I simply enter a space in between them, then I've got a piece of text. And this piece of text in this case is just simply a space. But if I want to add this space in between, then I'm going to need an extra one of these, because then basically I'm going to have to join three elements together, which is the first name, this little piece of text, and then the last name. So I'm going to need an extra one of these, and I can get one right here. Just click it. Okay, and now let's get this one. Let's cut it and paste it in here. Okay. So the extra spaces probably don't matter too much, but I always like to keep this thing kind of clean, and I like to see if there aren't too many spaces in between. So now I've joined three elements together. I've got my field name, first name, I've got my piece of text, which is just simply a space in between quotation marks, and I've got my last name. So that looks pretty good. Let's hit OK. Let's see what happens. And there we go. The space is in there. This is kind of cool. Now I can use this field instead of these two like separate fields. I think this does look a little bit better. So then we can just say contact or something like that. We can get rid of this one. We can get rid of this one. We can get rid of this one. Just double click this one and let's change it to our full name field. Okay, well that is pretty good. But I was actually a little bit too quick in removing all those fields. There is one improvement that I would like to make to this. Let's go back to File Manage Database. And let's look at this one. I have turned this into a calculation, which is good. Actually, you know what? I'll just go right back and add those fields back real quick. I'm going to say first name. I'll just create the label in here. And then I'll just Alt-drag this one here. And then I'm going to say last name. Okay, cool. So if I change something, like I'll turn this into Judy Snow, then this one updates as well immediately, which is kind of cool. And there, it updates again. So that's kind of handy, and that's what a calculation does. It's always going to update right away. But a calculation also has to calculate, like all the time. And that might make your file a little bit slower. If you have a lot of records and a lot of calculations, your file could be getting a little slower. Now, a first and last name are things that you enter once, and once you've entered them, normally speaking, unless you've made a mistake, they're going to stay the same. And so what you could do is instead of making this a calculation, you can just make it a simple text field that also does the calculation, but does it only once and then stores that full name as a simple text, because that way you have a simple text field that doesn't always have to recalculate. And that's a kind of makes your system a little bit faster, because this calculation could slow you down. Now, if these values, these two fields that you're using in your calculation, are both inside the same table, then making this a simple text field is not a problem. However, if you're doing calculations with fields that are in other related tables, then you might have to use a calculation, and you might be kind of forced to use the kind of the calculation that might slow you down a bit, but you don't have any other options. But here, all these both fields are in the same table, so we can do this in a slightly better way. So let's change this one to a simple text. Then I'm going to hit change. And now my calculation is gone, but if I double click this one, I see that in my auto enter options, I've got the ability to create a calculated value. And when I do that, that calculation that I just had still shows up, because I probably want to use this one. And it's correct, that's exactly what I want to do. So let's hit OK. Okay, that's good. Let's see if that works as well. Let's go and have a look. So my names are in here. These are also still in here because they were already calculated before. Let's create a new record. This one is empty. Let's do a first name. Let's say Julia Dench. Okay, let's tap. Oops, let's click outside. It's been sorting, so that's kind of annoying because now it's flooped around. So what I can do is I can go to sort records and I can kind of uncheck this and clear and unsort so that it's not always like flooping around. So I made my Julia Dench, and something's gone wrong here. The last name hasn't shown up here. And the reason that it hasn't shown up is because when I typed my first name, and I kind of went to the second field, every time you go outside of a field, the value in that field is being saved. And as soon as I did that and I went to the next field, my auto enter calculation got entered here, but at that moment it only had the first name and not the last name. And it did my calculation, and then when I entered my last name, this calculation did not get updated. And the reason for that is, let's go to File, Manage, Database, is because there is this tiny little checkbox here that says do not replace the existing value of the field, if any. And this one is always checked by default, but in this case I would like to uncheck this one so that when I enter the last name, my calculation here, my full name, does get updated. And ever if I find out that I made a typo, then I want to be able to edit that name, and I want my full name to be updated as well. So in this case, I want to be able to replace the existing value. So let's hit OK and let's see what that does. Now I've got a typo in here, so let's undo this, because this one is only going to update if I update one of those two fields. So let's and of course, as soon as I change a value, nothing happens yet. Things will only happen when you exit a field, because that's when the field gets saved. So either I hit my tab, like I just did, and then we can see that this has now been updated. If I change anything here, like I find out that her name is not Julia but Louise, then I can update this. And as soon as I click outside of it, the full name gets updated as well. But the advantage that I have right now is that I've got a simple text field here, which will get updated if I make a change in any one of the two tables that are present in that calculation. So it's basically like a calculation field, but faster. And I like that. That's kind of cool. So now I can get rid of these two fields right here. This looks kind of neat. I can sort it by last name if I want. Now, my last name field is not showing up here right now because it's showing me only the fields that are present in the current layout. But of course, in my contacts table, I do have all of these fields, so I can choose any one of these to sort, even if that field is not visible on the layout, I can still use it. So I'm going to use sort by last name, boom, and now I've got Dench, Hoover, Quincy, Snow, Styles. Okay, kind of good. So now what I was trying to do the whole time is I would like to be able to click one of these contacts to be able to go to their details directly. So this needs to become a button. Let's go into edit layout, let's select this one, and if we right click we can see that there actually is a button set up. Very simple. Now one thing to know about this button setup is that, let's exit for a second, if you click inside any one of these records, that record will become active, and you can see that here on the top as I'm clicking through these. The record that I'm clicking on becomes active. So the thing is, what I need to do is I just need to go to that other layout and see the active record. So like for instance, if I click on Judy Styles here and I go to my layout of contacts, then Judy Styles will be the record that shows up because that's the current like active record. So if I go to my list and I click on Louise Dench and then I go to my lay contacts, then Louise Dench is the one that shows up. So basically the only thing that I need to do is go from my list contacts to my lay contacts. Now this is looking kind of funky, so I'm going to make another table for this list later on. But first I will make this button, and if we remember correctly, the action that we need to do is very simple. Just simply go to that other layout. So I'm going to make this a very simple single step button. And here I've got all of my script steps that I can do, and it's a very simple go to layout. Now what I can do is I can try to find this here, and I actually don't have any idea where that is. Oh, navigation maybe, go to layout. So I could find it here and click it and enter it here, and then I could say original layout lay contact. Okay, that is one way to do this, but if I don't know where to find it here and if I don't want to go looking, I can just, I'm gonna undo this for a second and delete this one, I can just type in here go to layout, and then that one shows up. I can hit the tab key to just select that one. Now I don't want to go to original layout, I'm gonna hit my space bar here and I'm gonna click layout. I want to just choose lay contacts. Okay, that's what I want to do, and in my options for this button I want to change the cursor to a hand when I go over that button, because that way it's very clear to me to see that it is a button. Now that I am here, I'm maybe quickly going to add another field just to kind of show you the difference between the fields. I'm going to say address, I don't want a label for this, and I'm going to just add, alt drag this one up on top here, address. Okay, then we can see the difference here. So I did not enter any addresses for the other ones, but now I can see in my cursor that my cursor becomes a little hand, and when I click it, I go to this other layout. Very cool. Now I want to be able to go back as well, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a button here that says show list. And if I want, I can just add an image as well by clicking here, and then I can choose an image like this or that. Okay. And then the action for this one is going to be a simple step. Again, a go to layout. But this time the layout is going to be the list of the contacts. Okay, okay, okay. Again, I'm going to change the cursor to a hand over the button. And so now I can go to my list, and I can go to any character I want, Edgar Hoover, go back to my list, Louise Dench, Louise Dench, perfect. This is some maneuvering that's working pretty well. The only thing that I've got right here is that it's not very obvious to me that this is a button. But what I always like to do is just take this one and give it a color like this one, like a blue, and then it kind of looks like a hyperlink that you can click on. You could even underline it if you want, and then it becomes a bit more obvious that this one is a button. Okay, cool. This is kind of cool. I've got my list of contacts. I've got my detail for my contacts. I can tab through here, and I can enter all of my information. This is looking pretty good so far. I'm starting to get a pretty fancy database. Now, my layout is starting to look pretty good, but it's missing some gimmicks. It's looking a little flat, and people do like gimmicks. So let's start adding some fun stuff to play with. Let's go and edit our layout, and we can see that we have an email address, and we can make a button so that we can automatically email that person. It's very simple. Let's just create a little button here, and then we can use an image from the images from FileMaker, and there must be an envelope here somewhere like this one. We can even make it a bit bigger. Okay, and then we'll make it do something. We'll make it do a single step, and it's going to be a send mail step. And if we do that one, we get some options here. Like the dialogue should be on, that's good. I'm going to send it via my email client, that's good. I'm going to send one email, and I'm going to send it to that person's email address. So here I can specify, oops, you can't read it very well. I can either specify a field name or a calculation. I have a field name, which is called email, that I can use. So I'm going to make an email to my contact. I don't really know what this is all going to be about, so I'm going to leave all the rest blank. Very simple stuff. I'm going to just use this one. And then in my button setup, I'm going to again change my cursor to a hand over this button. Okay, that's looking pretty good. My button is looking all right, I guess. And I'll just put it right here. Now, if I want this button to stand out a little bit more, what's always fun is here you have these different styles. This is a blue one. This is green. This is kind of red, yellow. I like yellow. So let's exit my layout. So if I click on this button, then a new email is made to John Snowy's address. It automatically shows up in here. I can enter a subject. I can enter a message, and I can simply send this email, which I'm not going to do right now. Okay, so that's kind of cool. That's kind of a cool gimmick. If we want, we can even take this further. If I don't really know what this envelope means, I could add a little help text to it. So I can click on this button, I can go here, and I can add a little tooltip that says send email. Okay, if we try out that one and we hover over here, then it says send email. That's kind of a handy help for people who don't know what this button does. If you want, you can even take that a step further. You can say, you can edit this, and you can say send email to, and then let's add some other element, and the element is the email address. Okay, let's see what that does. If we exit this one, it says send email to john@snow.com. See, this is a kind of a fun gimmick and a nice way to make everything in your file very clear so that people always know exactly what's going on. Okay, another way to kind of beauty this up a little bit is, well, I've got a contacts database here. Maybe we have pictures of our contacts. That's kind of cool, and that will really make this look a little more flashy. So let's go to File, Manage, Database, and let's add a picture field. Now, the type of field is going to be a container field because it's going to contain a picture. Very simple. Let's create that one. Let's hit OK. And then let's reorganize this stuff a little bit. So my remarks might want to move a little bit. Let's say to the bottom right here. And then I will, let's just put it here for now. And then I will add a new field here. Let's put it up top. And it's going to be my picture field. And I would like for that to be a bit more square, maybe, or maybe a little bit widescreen format. Okay. Like this, and then let's exit the layout. And then what I can do is I can right-click it, I can insert a picture, and then I can just check one, select one from here maybe. And let's see, I've got a happy smiling man. Who is this? Jon Snow. Well, this is my Jon Snow. Who do I have here? Judy Styles. Insert a picture. Do I have a smiling woman? Yes, I do. There you go. That automatically immediately makes my file look a lot snazzier. So that's kind of cool. Okay, what else can we have? I mean, we're playing with gimmicks now. Let's see if we've got any more gimmicks to add here. For instance, this one is a web viewer tool, which is pretty handy. Let's add that one here. And what we could do with that is I can either do a custom web address. For instance, if my contact has a website, I can just use that field as a web address, but I don't have that right now. But what I do have here is a bunch of Google Maps options right here. So let's use the US Maps option and let's see what address do we want to show. Well, the address of my contact. Pretty cool. So if I want to just know where my contact lives, I can just specify the field name as being my address. The city is going to be my city field. State, I don't have state, but that's not a disaster. And I've got a zip code. You can add a state field to your file if you want. Now country, I don't have a field for that. You could either just manually enter the country if it, all of your contacts are going to be in the same country. If not, maybe this is enough for FileMaker 2 or for the Google Maps to find that address. You've got a bunch of options here. I think I'm gonna just leave them as they are. And then let's have a look at what this looks like. It's loading right now. No results found for your search. Well, obviously I don't have any results in here. Let's go to my John Snow. I do have an address for him. And well, it's found something, but I can't see it. It's kind of small. Now on my screen, I do have a lot of space to make my layout bigger, but if you just have a small layout, or if you're gonna use this file with a, let's say an iPad, you will see that in my file, there are these orange lines here. Those orange lines, they come from this option right here. This is the iPad. And I usually like to kind of keep my layouts at the size of the iPad. So that means that I do can maybe add a little height here. And I actually don't need to use the footer, so I can even delete the footer by just selecting the footer and hitting the delete button. Then I can make my layout a little bit bigger, which is kind of cool, but I don't think that even that is going to help me much. I still can't really see anything. So if you have a situation like this where there is just too much data on one screen, what you can use is a tab object. A tab control, like you can see here. Now, if you've already kind of filled up your layout a bunch, then that's a little bit difficult to kind of get started with. But, well, let's see if we can figure it out, shall we? Let's maybe put this one on top here for a second. Let's put the remarks, like maybe somewhere here. This is looking quite messy, but maybe I'll be able to figure it out. Let's take my tab control and let's put it here. Let's make it as big as I can possibly make it, like so. And then I can have some tabs. Now I've got my web viewer, like my maps, so I can make one for that, but I've got my info as well. So let's do contact info. Okay, let's create that as a tab and let's say maps, map, just simple map. You could even do website if you want. Let's create that one. Okay, cool. Let's say that that's kind of okay. Okay, so now I get three tabs. So I've got my map here. So let's try and see if we can get this one. Let's make it a bit smaller for now. Let's put it on here. Okay, cool. So that's already on here. We can now even make it bigger again. This website one I don't have yet, but my contact info I do have. So what I'm gonna do is make this again as big as I can make it, and then I'm gonna start adding stuff to it, like let's say my picture can be on this side. Okay, my remarks, let's shrink them a bit for now, because what I want to do is I want to make this one really big. You know what I'm gonna do? I'm just gonna select all of this stuff. Actually, I'm gonna make my remarks really small, put them here, and then I'm gonna just select all of this stuff. I'm going to cut it, and then make this one bigger. Maybe like so, and then I'll just paste it right here. Then I have to kind of drag it on here so that it looks kind of good, and get my remarks. I'll put them down here. This is starting to look better. Ooh, yeah, I can make big remarks if I want. There. Let's have a look at this. Let's exit my layout. Okay, so I've got my map here. This is kind of small still, so let's edit the layout and make this map a little bit bigger. Okay, cool. So now I've got these different tabs, and now everything inside the tab can be of like the full size. Okay, let's make this one as well. I don't have an a website address field yet, but I can easily add that one by going to File Manage Database. Let's say website. This can be a simple text. Okay. And then I can add this field here. So maybe I need to move my gender a little bit. I can add a new field here. All right. This could be my website field, and I want to create a label for this one. Let's make it a bit larger. And there you go. And let's say that this one is HTTP www.letsayheworksforyahoo.com. There you go. And then what we can do is we can just put another web viewer right here. We can make it big, and we can say custom web address, and the web address is going to be not this mess, but I'm going to specify it, and I'm going to just delete all of this, and I'm going to say use my website. There you go, my website field. Okay, so now what I've got going on is I've got these two web viewers, and if I click from the one to the other, you can see that they differ quite a bit in size, and that looks kind of messy. So I like to usually kind of keep them the same size. One way to do that is to just kind of either start by copying this one and pasting it in here, or to just take all the values from this one and to kind of bring them over to this side. So this map is 37 from the left and 147 from the top. So let's start with that. So 37 and 147 from the top. There you go, I've got them in the correct position here in the corner. That's good. Just the size is not the same, so the width is 917 by 475, 917 by 475, whoops, 5. Okay, if I do that, then they should be the exact same size and on the exact same position. They're just going to be showing some different kind of information. So let's have a look. The map is showing me all the maps information. That's kind of cool. And I can immediately start working with this. I can click this navigate button, and then I can add an address. And I can just kind of look around in here as well. So this is pretty handy. And let's look at this one. Is this working? Does this website even work? Apparently it does. So that's kind of cool. All right. So this already makes our file a whole lot fancier. This is kind of cool. It looks fine. It's got a lot of functionality to it. I think I'm already starting to get pretty happy with this file. All right, so this is starting to look pretty good. Let's maybe, because I've got a small resolution here, I'm gonna maybe put this one up a little higher. Make this one a bit smaller so that this one go up a little bit as well. Let's keep my layout a bit smaller so that this works for my screencast. Okay, cool. What I usually like to do is so that I know kind of which person I'm dealing with, I like to add their name in large to the top, like kind of like what I've got here. But of course, if we just add a text with a name, we can't just manually enter the name. The name needs to be entered, of course, depending on the value that's in these fields. So what we can do then is either we can just put a field in here with the person's name, and we can use the full name. But then you have that field, which I don't know if you want. If you just want to use a normal text, what you can do is you can do insert merge field. It's basically what you would use in like a Word letter if you want to insert some like variable data in there. So we can just insert a field here. So let's do that. And then it gets these like two funny brackets in the front and in the back. And then you get the full name. So if we exit our layout, it shows the exact same thing, but I think layout wise, this looks a little bit better than this one. So let's do it that way. So you can use a field or a merge field. I'm just going to get rid of this one, and I'll make this one a little bigger. There you, oof, it's very big. And let's put it here. Okay, looking pretty good. There you go. It's very clear now. I'm in my contacts, and I'm looking at my contact, Jon Snow. All right, so this is starting to look pretty handy. Now, of course, FileMaker is a relational database system. And we kind of have to, we've made one table now, but what we can do is we can create multiple different tables, and then we can kind of relate them so that they kind of work together. And this might sound like it's very complicated, but it's actually very simple. And we can actually learn how this works by doing a pretty simple exercise. Let's say, for instance, that I've got my contact here, and it's a person that I'm working with, and I want to make, for instance, a note, or there is something that I need to do. Like, I want to have a to-do list that is a task that I need to do for this person. I could write it in here, and I could say, call him soon. I could do that. But then, what if I have a bunch of different notes? This is eventually going to become a bit of a mess. So what I could do, because this is kind of my remarks about this person in general, I don't really want to put something like a to-do note in there because that's just not the right place for it. So what I could do is I could file, manage, database. I could make a to-do field. Field, it could be a text field. Great. And then I can put that on here. Or let's see. Okay, to do, create label, great, great, call him soon, great. So that is kind of handy, but what if I want to maybe have the ability to write more to-do tasks? Very simple, file, manage database, let's make a to-do too. That sounds funny and all, great. So now I can just edit my layout, take both of these, or just take only this one. I can alt drag this one down to do two, and let's voila. Okay, call, let's say maybe create prize offer for bagels. Why not? Okay, so now I've got two things that I have to do. I have to call him soon, and I have to create a prize offer for him. Okay, what if I want to write down another note? Well, I can make another field and another field. What if I want to write down 7 notes or 17 notes? It's probably starting to become apparent that this is not the best way to do this. This system is not very flexible. It will become a bit messy. Let's say if I have 10 boxes like this, and then there's maybe one task that I've done, so I will delete that one, but then there are other tasks, and it could become a pretty big mess soon. Now, the way that I could explain this to you guys, maybe is I can use an example a little bit like this. This is my Excel sheet, and actually if we go back into our contacts list here and we modify and add a couple of fields, like for instance we have our gender, so all of the rest can be added, then we can see in the end that we have our to-do fields here. And as you can see, they are all, the whole table that we have going on is all of the field names are on top, and all of my different contacts are kind of vertically below each other, and all of their information is in a horizontal row. Let's look at this one again. So we have our contacts, we have an ID, first name, last name, and we have a note. But as you can see, for every single contact, we only have like one row of stuff. And if we want to make multiple notes, we can just do that. Oops, we can make note one, we can make note two, or like actually those are to do. We can make to do one, and then to do two. And this is just not very handy, not very flexible. And the reason that this is not handy is because you're kind of stuck in this horizontal row where you can add multiple fields, but it's just not the handiest way to go. What you would actually need is you would actually have to be able to kind of go vertical, and so you can write multiple to-do notes. But of course you can't do that here, because if you're going to go down one row vertically, you're going to be arriving in the other guy's record. So if you wanted to do a note for Jon Snow and you write it here, then this to-do note is actually for Edgar Hoover. So what you could then think is, well, let's add a row below and let's do another to-do note here. But then what you've got is you've got 1, 2, 3, contacts, but actually you only have two contacts and like one, two, three to-do notes, for instance, if you would think these away for a second. So you can see that this is not, there's kind of a conflict here. You are in the contacts table and you only need have one record for each contact, so this one doesn't count. So what you would need is, let's drag this one in here. This is a new one. Let's say that we have a notes table, right? Or a to-do table. And then we could say, I have something to do. And call him soon and create offer. Okay, so that's handy because now I can make as many notes as I want. And every note can have its own ID. And let's say this is note number one, this is note number two, and so forth and so forth. Now, if I could have kind of that kind of system and I could combine it with this kind of system, that would be pretty cool. Then I can forget about these two, so I can just delete these columns. And then I can just say, well, I've got a contact right here. And actually, there is already a trick kind of visible here. This is contact ID number one. What if I would be able to refer to a certain contact in here, and I could say that these two notes are both for this first contact. If I can do that, then I can maybe create a good combination between these two systems and I can make this all work together. So what I need here is to be able to say for which contact these notes are supposed to be. So I'm going to say contact ID, and I'm going to say that this one is for contact one and this one is also for contact number one. And if I want to make a note for my contact number two, then I can just say, well, for contact number two, I would like to create note number three, which says, wish him happy birthday. Okay, so now I have two notes for my contact number one and one note for my contact number two. This is awesome because this is super flexible. I can make as many notes as I want and I can make them for whichever contact I would like. And if I want, I could even start adding new fields here. So I could say, what is the date that I made this note? Has this note got maybe a status? Let's say that this one is complete. And this one is maybe incomplete. My view was a little small here. So now I've got a super cool kind of flexible system going on and where I can do pretty much whatever I want. So this is what we're gonna make in FileMaker. And if you are looking at this, then you're basically already seeing the table that I'm gonna have to create. I've got an ID field, a to-do where I just enter my note. I've got my contact ID, which is basically the ID of my related contact. I've got my date, I've got my status, and all of the fields that I want. Okay, so let's get rid of these and let's make this system in FileMaker. And this is always a good kind of way to go if you want to try and figure out what fields you need in your table. So now if you go to File, Manage Database, we have got one table of contacts. So let's add a new table of to-do. Let's create that one, and if we double click it, we will arrive in the Fields tab, so we can start creating our fields. Now, if you remember, we always have an ID field, which is of the type number. We're going to create that one. We're going to immediately double click it, because otherwise we might forget to put this in auto-enter serial number. That's good. And then we're going to need all of those other fields. If you remember, we have to relate this note to one of our contacts, so we're going to say contact. And I'm going to call this one IDFK, and FK stands for foreign key, because that is not the key of the note, but this is the key of the contact who is in another table. That's why it's a foreign key. This field is also called a key field, because this is the field that uniquely identifies, in this case, each to-do item. But I'm going to store my contact ID here, and that's going to be coming from another table, foreign key. That's just database speak. This is also going to be a number field. Then I will have my actual to-do note, which will be a text. I could have a date, like I said, and if we go and cheat in here, then we can see that date is actually a type of field, so I can use that. That's kind of cool. Then I could have, let's say, urgent, if to note if that is an urgent to-do task or not. This could just be a simple text field. Okay, let's create that one. I could have a status, which is also a text, and that could be complete or incomplete or in progress, something like that. Let's see if I need anything else. No, I think this looks kind of good. Okay, let's look at this. Let's think and let's see if there is anything that we need to add. My ID is a serial number, that's good. My contact, that's where I enter the number of my contact. My to-do text, okay, my date. You know what I can do? The soon as I create that to-do item, my date could get filled in, because if I create a to-do item today, then that date of that to-do item, the date that I created it, is today. So I can make FileMaker do that automatically by just double-clicking, and I've got this auto-enter, and I've got a creation date. It's already suggested here, so that's good. As soon as I create this new record, it will be receiving a date in the date field. That's kind of cool. So it auto enters the creation date. Okay, is it urgent or not? I don't know, but what is the status? I think as soon as I make a to-do item, the status has to be incomplete, because I just created that one. And if I make it incomplete by default, then I can always see a list of complete or incomplete to-do items. That's kind of cool. So I'm going to auto enter data here, and I'm going to say incomplete. Because you could also have a button for it to set incomplete, but then if you forget to set a new task as incomplete, it's going to get kind of messy. And also, it just has to be incomplete. A new to-do item is always going to be incomplete, because you still have to do it. Okay, that's kind of cool. And that way, if you're kind of smart about the data that gets entered automatically, then you make your database a lot easier and it will work a lot better. Okay, this looks kind of good. Okay, now this is kind of a lesson about relational database design, so we're gonna have to get in here, and you might be a little bit scared or worried, because this might look like it's a bit difficult, but don't worry about a thing. Now let's start with the fun thing. What we can do is we can give these boxes a color, so let's do that. That's kind of fun. See, this area is not so scary at all. It's actually kind of fun. So we have our contacts right here. This is our contact table, and it still has these two to-do fields in that I'm not going to need, because I'm going to be using this to-do table. And now we're going to have to create a relationship between these two. Now, how on earth is that going to work? Well, let's get these guys back. So these are my contacts, and this one here are my tasks. So if we put them both on the screen, then is there any way that we can figure out a field that is going to be the same in both of these tables? So I've got my ID, first name and last name, and I've got my ID, to do, contact ID, date and status. And I think the smart ones amongst you have already figured it out. The value in this ID field is going to be the same as the value in this ID field. So for this Jon Snow, who has ID number 1, this value is the same as the value in both of these fields. So basically this field is kind of going to be related to this field, because they will have the same value in them. And that is kind of the essence at understanding relational databases, is the relationship will be between two fields that have the same data in there. And I'll show you exactly how that works. Let's get rid of these guys again. So we have our contact's ID, which is contact number 1, contact number 2, and that same value is going to be in the contact ID foreign key field. So if we just simply take this one and drag, then we get this little line, and we just simply drag it to this field, and we let go, then we get this is equal sign. And that basically explains the whole thing, because the contact ID, the number of the contact, is going to be the same as the contact ID in my to-do table. So if I'm at my contacts in my contact table and I'm looking at my contact number 1, then I want to be able to see only the notes where the contact ID number 1 is the same here as it is here. So I only want to see my to-do items for contact number one. And that's what this is equal relationship is all about. It's going to show me fields in here where this value is the same as this value. Sounds very complicated, but that's kind of very simple if you visualize it using those two Excel kind of sheets that I just showed you. Okay, so this is kind of cool. This is a good start, but there is one thing we do have to do. We do have to edit our relationship. So let's double click this one here, and then we get a whole bunch of options right here. So we have two columns. On the one side we have our contacts, and on the other side we have our to-do items. Now what I would like to do is, if I am on my contacts table, I want to be able to create to-do items. So if I want to be able to do that, I have to kind of check this box right here. So this box means that I want to allow the creation of to-do records in this table, in the to-do table, via this relationship. So I want to be able to create to-do items. That's why I have to check the one underneath to-do. So this is actually the same box, but I'm not going to be creating contacts from being on the to-do layout, because that is a bit weird. I'm always going to be creating contacts here and then creating to-do items as well. So I want to check this box. Now the next box might seem a little complicated if you just read it. It says delete related records in this to-do table when a record is deleted in the contacts table. And it's actually very simple. The question here is, what do I want to do with my to-do records of a certain contact when I delete that contact? Well, in this case, in the case of the to-do items, I think that if you delete a contact, you're not going to need their to-do records anymore, because they'll become pretty useless. Now this contact has been removed from your system, so you don't want to have a bunch of to-do records that are left that are related to a contact who doesn't exist anymore. So in this case, if I delete a contact, I also want to delete this contact's to-do records, because otherwise they're going to stay behind. They will be orphaned records. That's kind of messy. I don't want that. So that's why in this case, I am going to check this box. But you always have to kind of ask yourself, what do I want to do with these records when I delete a record in this table? So in some cases, you might want to check this box. In other cases, you don't. In this case, I do. Let's hit OK. Let's hit OK again. And now, so I still have this messy system that I don't like. So let's just get rid of these. I don't want those. Then let's go into File, Manage Database. Let's go to the fields of contacts. Let's get rid of these two because they are kind of a mess. I don't want them. I'm going to come up with a far fancier solution right now. And let's see, where are we going to put this stuff? Again, there's not a lot of room, so let's just double click our tabbed object and let's add a to-do list. Let's create that one. I want to bring this one a little bit closer, so let's move it up. And okay, that's kind of cool. So now I have my contact info and my to-do list, which is still empty. And here I am going to put a kind of a list of my to-do items, because I want to have the ability to add lots of them. And then I want to deal with them. But what I have to do now, this table or this layout is based on the table contacts. And I now want to get information on this layout from a related table. And I can look at the records of a related table by using what FileMaker calls a portal. And so that's a good name, because it's like a portal into a related table. That's kind of cool. Of course, the word related is very important here. You cannot just show records from an unrelated table, because FileMaker will have no idea what to show you, because there is no relationship between the two of those. But our, as you remember in our relationship diagram, we did create a relationship, so this is going to work and it's going to be pretty cool. So let's click our portal tool right here. Let's make a box. I'm going to leave a little room here for labels up top, so I'm going to go start a little lower, and I'm going to make it nice and wide and nice and high. Now I want to show related records from a related table. I have one related table right here, and I have no unrelated tables because I just don't have any more tables. And the related table is, of course, the to-do table. That's kind of good. Do I want to sort my portal records? Well, maybe I do. Maybe I want to sort them by date. And then maybe, yeah, maybe that's good. Do I want to filter them? Well, not right now. Do I want to allow the deletion of portal records? Yeah, sure. If I enter a note and that is a mistake or something, I want to be able to delete that note from here. So I do want to allow the deletion of portal records. That's kind of cool. And do I want to allow vertical scrolling? I guess so. And then what else do I need? I have 15 rows, that's fine. And then I'm gonna click OK. You can also use the alternate row state, and that's kind of cool because then you get like a white and a gray and a white, gray, and then it's easier to kind of distinguish the different rows. So what do I want to show here? I don't want to see the to-do ID because that's a number that's totally irrelevant to me. Shall I see the contact ID? You know what? I don't want that one, but I might use it later to show you something, but I'll just do that later then. The to-do item, sure, I want that. I want the date. Is it urgent or not? And what's its status? Those are all fields that I do want to have, so let's click OK. And then we can see that our portal is there, and it has four fields in it. Now, the thing that annoys me all the time, especially when using this theme, is that I can't see the edges of those fields. I can see it like this, but not like this. And that's because if you go to the styling here, this is a minimal edit box, and it doesn't have any borders. I don't like that. So in my portal, I always select them all and turn them into the default style. And then if you see, they have kind of borders around them, which makes it a bit clearer to see. Okay, let's exit our layout and let's see what we've got. We've got our to-do list right here. And if I look at it like this, it looks a little bland. It's not very clear at all. I have no idea whatsoever what I need to do with this. So let's go back into our edit layout and let's add some labels. And that's why I left some space in the top. Let's take my text tool and let's say to-do. And then let's just go and drag these guys a bit to the side. And then I'm going to hit Alt and drag this one. This one says date. Okay, but I'm already seeing that this looks kind of annoying because, well, my date is here and it's kind of huge. It doesn't have to be that huge. And I know from experience that, let's say, 120 is about enough. And I don't want to manually enter a date. So let's go to our data thingy here. Tab, and then let's create a drop down calendar and let's include an icon to show and hide this calendar, and that's this little icon right here. And that's kind of cool because then if I click on it, I get a calendar and I can more easily enter a date. Now, I'm not really liking the way that this has been set up because my date, I think it should be in the beginning, maybe. Yeah, let's do that. Let's get let's do this. Let's line these up in the front like so. Then let's get this one out of here. And then I need to get this label here. And I need to get this label here. Okay, that looks better. So my date, I have a to-do item, which can be a bit larger. Then is this urgent or not? You know what I'm going to do with this? I will make this a little checkbox. So I'm going to make this a checkbox set. And I'm going to get a new value list going because I only have one, which is for the gender, which is what I don't need. And I'm going to create a value list name that is called yes when checked. So my value is yes. Okay, cool. So when I check that box, the value will be yes. And if I do that, I get this little checkbox, which is kind of cool. And that makes this one, you know what, because this now says yes. I can do two things. Either I change this back to urgent, or what I can do is I'm going to make this really small. Then I'm going to change the font size a bit, make it a bit bigger. Oh yeah, that's kind of, maybe that's too large. Something like this. Yep, if I go in here, I can make this 20 by 20, for instance. Yep, and then I can just make the label here. I can make it say urgent. Oh yeah, that's cool. Okay, this might be a little confusing if I use the yes when checked for this, so I'm gonna make a new one and I'm just gonna say urgent, and then we'll just use the value urgent. It might make a bit more sense. Okay, so now I have this one already. I use this a lot, so I just keep it. Okay, and then my status, That needs a label, so let's add a label here. Let's call it status. Oops, I can't type anymore. Great. So actually, this one can kind of stay here. I'm gonna line these up using this button right here so that they're nicely lined up. And then I have a lot more room for my to-do thingy here. And actually, what I'm gonna do is move this over like something like this. Yep. Okay, cool. Let's see what this looks like. So I can just enter a to-do item. Let's say call him soon. Is this urgent or not? Yeah, let's say this is urgent. And the status of this task is that it is incomplete. Okay, so this is kind of cool. The date is filled in automatically because that's my auto-enter date. And actually, to be truly honest, maybe for this reason, I might want to change these back. Because if this date field is the first field here in my layout, then I might be tempted to fill that date in. And that's actually not necessary because it gets filled in automatically. So maybe I should then put the date here. There you go. That way I don't feel the need to kind of fill that in. There, it's better. I'll just start typing in here and then my date gets filled in automatically. That's kind of better. Okay. How about this? Okay, so that's kind of cool. Now I can just enter something, make price offer, and as soon as I tab ahead, this date is kind of filled in automatically. And if I want, I can change it, but ideally, no, I will not. Okay, cool. This is looking okay, but we can kind of spice this up a little bit. This is looking kind of dull. We can make this a little bit more fun. But maybe one thing I do have to show you guys, which I was talking about before, let's edit the layout, let's add a field real quick, let's just put it on top here, it's just like temporarily, and let's add from the to-do table, let's add our contact IDFK, let's not create a label, and let's just drop it up here. And now let's have a look. Because our contact ID, it says here number 3, and if we go into our to-do, and we put this in table view, then we can see that our contact ID has been filled in automatically. That's kind of cool because I didn't even fill this in myself. Let's go to the contacts again, and let's go to a different contact. Let's go to our Jon Snow, and let's say send birthday card. And that's kind of urgent because he's going to have a birthday soon, for instance. And this one gets the ID, the contact ID number 1 automatically, and I didn't even fill that in as well. Let's delete that field again, and let's go and have a look at our to-do table again. You can see that that these contact IDs are getting filled in automatically. And the reason, of course, for that is because I am on my layout of my contact, and I make a note in a related table. If we go to our relationship graph, FileMaker knows that the value in this to-do record, in this field, this value needs to be the same as this. So FileMaker automatically fills that in because it knows that that to-do item is for that contact that I am currently on right now. So that value gets filled in automatically and you don't have to worry about that. So that is pretty cool. Okay. So now, how can we make this even more fun? Like, let's say that I type a mistake and I want to delete this to-do item because I kind of made a mistake. There was this option that I set before that says allow deletion of portal records. So I am allowed to delete portal records. The problem is I just can't right now. I can't. Maybe I can like this. Let's see if I hit delete. Oh yeah, I can actually delete like this. But that's kind of tricky, and my user is never going to know that. So I need to make it so that I am actually allowed to do this in a slightly easier way. Now, this field is a little too big, so I can make it smaller. And then what I can do is I can put a text here, and I could type delete. That's kind of cool. Then I can turn this into a button, and this button can have the simple single step of delete portal row, but you have to really be careful now because there are a couple of different delete options. You have delete account, which you don't really want to do. You have delete all records, which you don't want to do either. Now, if you read what it says here, there is an explanation. It deletes all the records in the current found set. That's not the one you want to do. Then you have a delete portal row right here, which deletes the selected portal row, which deletes data in a related record. And that's kind of what we want. We want to delete a portal row. But you might be a bit confused and you might think that it's delete record request, but if you use that one, it will delete the current record and so it will delete that contact. Because you always have to remember, we are working here with to-do notes here, but we are still in a record of a certain contact. So we are, we have a record that is the record of the contact, but we do have a related record in the portal row, and that is the to-do record. So now in this portal row, if we want to delete something, we want to delete the portal row. That's very important to remember. And I'm going to keep my dialog on, because I can also turn it off, but my dialog is gonna ask me if I definitely do want to delete that record, and I do wanna kind of get that extra warning just in case I accidentally clicked my delete button. Okay, so let's make this okay. Let's again turn this into a hand cursor. This text is not very obvious, so I can make it blue. Okay, and that will allow me, let's see, where did I have my mistake? Didn't I type a mistake note somewhere? Guess not. Then mistake. Okay, so I can now delete this mistake and now it's gone. So that's kind of cool. Now, instead of using a little text, I can also use a little image. I can insert a picture, and if you use kind of like a PNG image, then you can use like an image that has some transparency, like a little red cross here. And then that PNG image with transparency looks pretty cool because you can kind of see the background through the parts that are transparent. And then that looks kind of nice. So this one, again, we do have to set up the button again, but this is delete portal, whoops, portal row. Okay, that's good, very simple. And let's set the cursor to a hand, and I think this looks a little bit better than having the word delete. So let's do that, and then we have this cute little red cross that we can click when we just made a mistake. Then we can just delete, and this is that dialogue that we could have turned on or off. It's on right now, so it is asking me. You can also turn that off, but then as soon as you click this button, that record will be gone and you will have no kind of way to say, oops, this was a mistake, I don't want to do that. Okay, so that makes this a little bit cooler. Is there any way that we can make this even more cool? Let's say I want to, for this one, also create a, I need to maybe create a bill for this person. A bill, and maybe that task is not urgent, but now I can't really see any kind of difference between the urgent tasks and the not urgent tasks. So what we can do is, let's say if a task is urgent, I want this task to be kind of highlighted. I want it to stand out. So what I can do is I can just, I want for all of these fields to stand out, or maybe not this one, just these two. Then what I want to do is I want to use some special formatting so that it looks a bit different, but it only needs to look different when that urgent field has been clicked. So it only needs to be formatted under a certain condition. And the smart guys amongst you have already figured it out. If I want to do some formatting under a certain condition, that is called conditional formatting. Now I can add something here, like I can add a conditioning formatting rule, and I have two options here. I can have a certain value, or I can use a certain formula. Now the value is usually something that you'll use when you just put conditional formatting on one field, and that conditional formatting is dependent on the value in that field itself. But now we're dealing with another field because we want the to-do field to be in a different color when the urgent field is checked. So I'm gonna have to use a formula to kind of explain how I want to do that. And I can specify this formula, and then I again get one of these like calculation dialogues, which is kind of handy. So I can say if my to-do urgent field, if that equals the value urgent, because we changed that value list from yes to urgent. So if the value in urgent is urgent, And I remember that when you refer to a field, you can just type that field. But if you refer to a value, you have to put it in these quotation marks. If it is urgent, then I would like my fill color to be kind of like a red, reddish. Okay, let's see if that actually works. You see, when I check this as being urgent, these two fields, which I had both giving that same conditional formatting to, they turn red. So that's kind of cool. And that makes this to-do list a little bit more kind of visual, and it makes it a little bit easier to kind of distinguish what's going on. Okay, now I can have this thing going on here. I have a status. It is incomplete. Let's say that I would like to have a few different types of statuses. Then I might want to turn this one into a drop-down list. And I can make a new value list for this, and it's going to be, let's say, to-do status. It could be incomplete, it could be in progress, or it could be completed. Okay, cool. So now, if we do this, what we can do is we could say create a bill that has been, or let's say that that's in progress, and let's say send mail, let's say that that has been completed. Okay, so now we have these different fields here with all kinds of different statuses, but again, it's not very visual. So we can again use conditional formatting, and this time we can use that, the value thing. We don't have to create a formula here because we're just going to change the formatting of one field, and it's just dependent on the value inside that field itself. So we're going to say that the value is equal to, let's say, completed. But here you do have to make sure that you have the correct value. So I don't remember if I used complete or completed, but I think I used completed. And we're going to use a fill color of green. And then let's have a look if that's already working. I do have to check what value that I had there. Oh yeah, I did have completed, and this one is already looking green. So that's kind of cool to see what's going on here. So let's do conditional formatting again, and we can just add more rules. We can add as many rules as we want. So if the value is equal to in progress, then I would like my fill color to be, let's say an orangey, maybe, orangish. Okay, good, and then I want to add maybe another one. If the value is equal to incomplete, then I want this maybe to be a bit of a reddish again, a reddish. Let's see if that works. To-do list. Okay, yes, my incomplete is red, my in progress is all yellowish, and my completed task is green. So that makes my file look again a hell of a lot snazzier, and it makes it a more fun to kind of look at, and it gives you an instant visual kind of cue of what's going on. If there's a lot of red, then you're going to start to get sweaty, and if there's a lot of green, then you're going to be kind of chill and relaxed. So that is kind of helpful. And of course, if you move from one contact to another, of course your task here, they update. All right, I think that is a very kind of cool and nice addition. I think we're really getting somewhere with this file. It's really starting to look pretty nice. A very important thing we're going to add right now, and I'm kind of missing something here, to be able to navigate through our file. There's not a lot to navigate yet. There's just this list and then my contact details. So there's not a lot of stuff to go, not a lot of places to go yet right now, but I'm going to start to add more layouts. And when I do, I'm going to need some sort of a central place to start from, which I call my menu. And this would be a good time to add that menu. The reason is I always like to, when I create new layouts, I always like to copy existing layouts and then just modify them so that they all kind of look the same. But in order to do that, I would like to already have as much information as possible on this layout so that I don't have to start adding stuff later. So what I'm going to do in the corner here is I'm going to add a button. Oops, like this, and I'm going to call this one menu. And that is currently doing nothing, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a script Whoa, should I do that already? No, I don't want to make you guys nervous yet. So let's just do a single step. I can't do that yet because I didn't make that layout yet. Okay, I'm gonna have to kind of do that later because we have to first make that layout. I'm gonna make this one 35 high because I think that's a good height, and then I'm gonna make this one 30 high because I think that's a good height as well. Then I can just kind of place this one at, let's say, 5 and 5. Okay, that's kind of good. And this one could be, let's see, somewhere there, let's say 100. Is that cool? 100? No, that's too close. 105 maybe. Okay, and 10 from the top. Yeah, that looks kind of neat. See, this looks kind of fancy. You know what, I'm gonna just do it anyway. I'm gonna create a script in my script workspace, and I'll make this a bit smaller, and I'm just gonna make this, is gonna be very simple, don't get nervous. I'm just gonna hit plus, and I'm gonna call this one go to menu, and I'm not gonna put anything in there yet. I'm just gonna go and do file. Do I need to do file save here? I always do just command S to save this script. I don't even know where the save script button is for this. Oh yeah, scripts, I think here somewhere, save script or something. Yeah, save script, it's right here. So, but I always use command S. So I'm gonna save my script. It doesn't do anything yet because I don't have that layout yet. But now that I've made my script, what's really cool about this is that I can put this button on all my layouts, and then I can just, it'll all be pointing at this one script, and then I can just edit the script later. So I'm gonna close this thing again because this is scripting, which probably makes you guys all very, very nervous. So I'm gonna click this button. I'm gonna remember where it is. It's 5 and 5. From the left and top. So I'm gonna go and copy this one. And when I am in layout mode, I can use this one to browse between not my different records, but to the different layouts. So that's kind of cool. I can just go all the way to begin, to the beginning. Now this one is in, my context was in table view, so I don't need that button there. This one is the one I just came from. This one is my list. So I'm gonna paste my menu button over here, and I'm gonna put it on 5 from the left and 5 from the top. Okay, that's kind of great. And then let's go on. Let's see, what else do I have here? This is my to-do list, but this one is also going to be in table view. So let's exit my layout. Okay, that's perfect. I've got my list, and actually I'm going to clean this up as well. I'm going to manage my layouts, and I'm going to create a new folder here for my lists. Oh, this is starting to become so nice. Okay, my list contacts can go in here, and this was actually a table, so it can go there. Oh man, I've got two tables, I've got one layout and one list view. This is starting to look so neat. Okay, now I've got my menu. I want to be able to go to my menu, and that will be my navigational spot to go everywhere I want to go. So let's make a menu. Let's go to File, Manage Database, and let's just make a simple table for this. I don't really need to do that, but I always like to do that. It gives me some possibilities later on. Menu, very simple. Let's double click this one. Let's add an ID field that's going to be a number, and let's double click this one, and let's check serial number here. I don't really need that in my menu, but I always think it's a good habit to do this for every single table. I don't really need to have any data in my menu right now, but one cute little trick that I always like to do is I want to create a C and then current and date, and that I want to be a calculation, because that way I can just show the current date in my menu. I do like that one. So I'm gonna create this one. Then FileMaker is gonna ask me, well, what kind of calculation do you want to use? And I want to show my current date. Now, there is a bunch of stuff in here, and the ones that we're gonna be looking at right now is gonna be the get function. We're gonna get the date of today, and get the date of today is actually get current date. So you can either double click that one and get it in here, or if you kind of know that one by heart, you can just start typing get and then one of these brackets, and then you can just type current, and then it already says date. So you can tab to select that one. And then again, always very important, if you're making a calculation, the calculation result is a standard, a number, but I'm getting a date here, so I don't want this to be number. I want this to result in a date. Very important. Okay, I want to do that, but also I want this to always remain the current date, so I'm going to double click this one again, and I'm going to go to the storage options, and I'm going to say that this one needs to not store the calculation results, because otherwise what it's going to do, it's going to get the current date today, but then tomorrow it will still have that value in there, and I don't want that. I don't want this to be stored so that it is gets recalculated every single time. That does make the system a bit slower, but it's just one field in one record that is not going to really have a big impact. And this way I can always get the correct date. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to my menu. I'm going to view this as a form, which is kind of cool. I don't really have any fields in here, so I don't necessarily need to view this in table view. So I'm going to go uncheck these so nobody can accidentally make a mistake and get into a list view and mess up their menu, so that this stuff all gets to go, because I don't need to see those. I'll make the header maybe a bit bigger so that I can put a big fat title in there. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to create my text here, and I'm going to say, I'm going to insert my current date in here. Insert merge field, we've done this before, and from my menu table I want see current date. Okay, I'm gonna line this out on this side, which is kind of cool. Then I'm gonna make it a lot bigger, so I have to click outside of it first so that I can set a big font size. Yeah, something like this. That looks kind of cool. Now I'm going to exit my layout, and I'm going to see that this one is showing me the date of today. That's kind of handy. I might want to add a title here as well. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to add, drag this over here so that it's nicely lined out. And then I'm going to type menu, but I want to line this out to the other side and maybe make this one even bigger. Oh yeah, that looks kind of good. Now we need to have some buttons in there to navigate, and I always like to insert a picture. And I have a bunch of these images here. So one of my sections in my file is that I have a contacts type thing. So I think I have a image of people, I think. Yes, I have this one or this one. It doesn't. Oh yeah, this one looks okay. And then I always try to make these buttons. I usually use a rounded rectangle. I make it somewhat kind of around this person. And then it's now covering the person, so that's not good. But in your position tab here, you have these arrange buttons. So you can arrange something to the back, for instance, or make it move one step up or down. And then you can kind of put your image back on top of this big box. And then I'm going to say contacts. There you go. Now this context can be lined out in the middle. This one kind of in the middle as well. And then let's see this size of this box. Let's see, how big is this one? It's 141. Do I want it to be that big? Let's see, 125. That looks kind of good. And then the height, 150 maybe. Yeah, I think that'll do for a button. Then what we're going to do is we're going to use this align to align this all in the center. And now what I can see is that my image could actually go a tiny bit higher, and then my text can go a bit higher as well. And this is starting to look like a nice looking button. So I can put this one up here, and now I have three items in here. I have my image and my text, but it's probably best if I use the big rectangle in the back to work as my button. So I'm going to select that one and go to button setup. I'm going to use a very simple single step, and it's going to be a go to layout. We've done this one before. We're going to choose our layout, and it's going to be our lay contacts. Okay, change the cursor to a hand over the button. And if we do that, then we can click on contacts, and it brings us straight to our contacts. We can then go to our list, and then we can choose someone, and then we can kind of go back and forth, and that's kind of fun. This button doesn't work yet because we hadn't finished that script, but now that we do have that new menu layout, we can go back to our script workspace. We can select our go to menu script, so make sure that we are in that script, and we can do a very simple go to layout, and we're going to choose the layout, and the layout is going to be menu. Okay, that's very simple, no need to worry about that. We're going to save. I'm going to hit Command S, and then we're going to close this one again. Don't worry about scripts right now. You don't need to be afraid of those. We're going to deal with those later. So let's now go to this button. Let's say button action, and actually it still says do nothing, but I want it to perform a script, and that script is going to be go to menu. And then actually I do want to have this to change to a cursor change the cursor to a hand over the button. That's a difficult sentence. Let's go to my list layout here because I had a menu button here as well. Let's do a, whoops, I missed it there. Let's do a perform script as well. Go to menu, and actually in the button setup, I want to check this box as well. So now wherever I am, if I'm in this list, I can go back to the menu, or if I'm in my contacts, I can always go back to my menu as well. And now my FileMaker file is starting to look like a real FileMaker file because I can very easily move around. That's quite cool. One more thing that we can't forget: if we want to open our file and arrive in this menu, we have to go to File, File Options, and then we have to do Switch to Layout, and then we have to select our menu so that we definitely always arrive in this menu every time we open our file. Now that we have our fancy schnazzy new menu, we're gonna have to put some stuff in there because it's pretty empty. And I have an idea. We have our contacts and we have our to-do list, but this to-do list is not very practical. If I want to know what I have to do, then I have to go in there and I have to kind of look at all of my contacts here and kind of go through them and find. And then if I go to another one, I will forget what the previous one was. This type of to-do list is not very handy. It's very handy if you want to enter something, like if someone calls you on the phone and you want to go to their to-do list and then you want to enter something, that is pretty handy. But when you actually have to do those things, you would like to get all those to-do items into one single list. Now, we did already create a list, obviously here, this is a list of all our contacts. And if you remember, our contacts are in a table, but our to-do items are also in a separate table. And that's kind of handy because now we can just make a list based on this to-do table. Pretty cool, right? So then we can get all our to-do items together. As I said before, what I like to do is, if I'm gonna make another list, I like to start from this list so that my list is the same, because I've put a button here, I've changed the size here, and I like to start from this one so that I have all my lists looking kind of similar. So I'm gonna go to File, Manage Layouts, and I'm gonna take this list and I'm just gonna simply duplicate it. Then I'm gonna double click it so I can change it a bit, and I'm gonna call this one List To Do, and it's going to show me the records not from contacts but from To Do. Okay, that was simple enough. Let's finish this. And now what's super important is that I sometimes make that mistake. I will go into Edit Layout and I will start changing stuff. But the thing is, I am still in my list contact. So I first have to go to my list to do. And if you really want to make sure that you don't mess this up, we can just go in here. We can go and edit this. We can just Alt drag this thing over here. We can just make our to-do list. We're going to insert a new picture right there. And I think I had something like, did I have to do or tasks? I have tasks here. Let's see. Oh yeah, that looks kind of good. I'm gonna select both of these images and then I'm gonna line them up together. Okay, now I'm gonna take the top one and place it backwards so I can get to this one. I can delete, and there you go. How snazzy is this button set up? I'm gonna make a single step and I'm gonna go to the layout, a list to do. Oh man, this is gonna be so awesome. And now I can click here and boom, now I'm in my list to do. That is so cool. Okay, one little problem though. I still have to edit this now. It's not really a problem, it's just something that I now have to do. So I have my contact, which is kind of cool. That's already there. Now let's see, I don't need to see my contact's address, so let's double click this one. Let's go to my to-do table and let's actually put the actual to-do item in there. And in fact, maybe what I should do is I should move this one to the back. There you go, that's better. And I can move this one to the front. Okay, and this is one to-do. Now I can make this look kind of similar to my portal. And so I can just kind of Alt drag this one here, give it two taps on my arrow key. There, I got a date, that's another field I have, and I can be smaller. That could be a drop down calendar with a icon right there. And I'm gonna go back to my position tab and I'll make this 120, that's a good size I think. And this one is simply date. Then I'm gonna start from this one again because my next one doesn't need to be a date field. Oops, this is a little low. Okay, what else do I have? I have urgent. Yeah, that was my checkbox, so urgent. and I'm gonna be making this one a checkbox set, and the checkbox was for urgent. So I can make this smaller again. If I remember correctly, I had set it somewhere to 2020, and then I had made the font size for this a little larger, because otherwise the checkbox is a little small. Then I can just take the two of them and line them out, kind of center lined out like this, and this one as well, and that way they line up nicely. And then what else did I have? I had my status, so let's drag this one over here as well, somewhere here. Okay, that looks kind of okay. Let's say status. Okay, status. And then let's make this one smaller. And then I had a drop down for this. Drop down. Oh no, that's not a drop down calendar. It's a drop down list. And it's going to be to do status. Okay, this is kind of good. But I'm missing all my colors. Now, I had set this one up already, so that was very simple. Conditional formatting. I'm going to add a formula that says, specify, that says if urgent is equal to urgent, then I want my fill color to be pink. Oops, right there. Let's see if that actually works. Okay, that's working. My urgent ones are actually pink. Now, I had three colors set up for this thing as well, but I don't want to do that whole thing again. That's kind of annoying. It's double work. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to cheat. I'm going to go to my other layout, this layout. This is the field with that conditional formatting, so I'm just going to copy it. And I'm just going to paste it. Oops, I don't want to do that. I'll just click here and then paste it again. That way it'll paste it here. So that's kind of cool. I'm just going to remove this one and then put this one in place. Okay, great. Yes, my colors are back. Okay, cool. So now this is kind of all right. This is cool. So now I've got my my lists, and I can see all my tasks, the tasks that I need to do here. Okay, is this already kind of cool? Yeah, sure, because I can just click on Jon Snow, for instance, and that'll take me to Jon Snow. No, it brings me to Louise Dench. Okay, cool. I'm going to have to change this. So this one is still a button that is still a button from before, and this brings me to a layout. Now, this works when I'm starting from a list that is based on the contacts table, but when I'm starting from the to-do table, this is not going to get me to the correct record. I'm gonna have to use a different step, because what I'm doing is I'm starting from a related table, from the to-do table, and I have to arrive in the contacts table. So I'm gonna delete this one, and there is a step for that, which is called go to related record, or no, it's called yeah, it is called go to related records. And if I select that one, I've got two options that I can fill in. So I'm gonna get my related record from the contacts, and I'm going to use the layout lay contacts. Great. I'm not going to show this in a new window, and I'm not going to show only related records, so I'm just going to leave those things unchecked. And then if I try this out and I want to go to Jon Snow, then I do actually arrive at Jon Snow. If I want to get to Judy Styles, then I will actually arrive at Judy Styles. So that is pretty cool. So that is kind of working. Okay. Now, this is kind of handy, but what if I make a new record? And I just type in here, let's say, pick up at airport. Okay, that's kind of cool. And that's incomplete. Yeah, okay, that's kind of cool. Only one problem now. If I do this, this new note is not related to any kind of contact. I could click on here, but it just doesn't work because there's nothing there. So if I go to my tables, my to-do items, I can see that there is one here, that pick up at airport, that is doesn't have a contact ID assigned to it. And I have to kind of make sure that I can do that. So what I can do in this layout is I can add my contact ID field. This is from to-do contact IDFK. All right, great. So that is here. And if I look at it now, then I can see that I've got all these IDs here. So what I can do now is I can do a lot of things. I can either manually enter a number. So I could say, for instance, number 2, and that is my contact, Edgar Hoover. So that works pretty well. But I don't really want to deal with these ID numbers, and I don't know these ID numbers. So what I'm going to want to do is I'm going to want to be able to select a person from a dropdown. So let's get this field here. Let's turn that into a dropdown, and let's make a new value list for the contacts. Okay, so I'm going to use values from a field, and the first field is going to be from contacts ID, because that's the value that I have to actually put inside that field. Remember, I typed a number 2 in there, so I need to get that ID into that field. But those IDs, of course, they don't mean anything to me, so I'm also going to display a value from a second field. And that field for me is going to be the full name field. And that's so a cool reason to have that full name field is now that I can see the full names into that dropdown. I'm going to show all the values because I want to see all my contacts, that's good, but I don't want to see those ID numbers, so I'm going to show only the values from the second field, so my full name. And if you remember, that C full name needs to result in a text, not in the number, because if that results in a number, this is the moment where you're going to get a bunch of question marks. So let's try this out. Let's exit our layout. Let's see if this drop down works. Hey, yes, it works. I can select any person that I want, and their name, like Zara Quincy, it just shows up here. So that's kind of cool. But now I've got these ugly kind of numbers in my list. I don't really want to deal with those numbers. I just want to see those names. But I do have to enter those numbers. Now there's a trick that we can use. What we can do is we can take this field. We can say that I want this field to be available in browse mode because I want to be able to enter data in it, but I don't want to see this field. I want to, let's say what I want to do is I want to put this field on top of that field. Now it's not going on top, it's going behind that field, but we can fix that with our arrange. We can bring this one to the top, and now my full name field is basically covering my my other field right there, my ID field. Now the problem is that I had to turn this one into a button, and so if I want to do this trick and I want to enter a value in here, I can't do that right now because it functions as a button and it brings me to somewhere else. So I can't have this field be a button. I can't do that. So I have to undo that. I have to go to button setup, and this one has to do nothing. Okay, so this cannot be a button. Also, it cannot be available in browse mode, because if it's available in browse mode and I click it, I will just be clicking to change the name in here, and I don't want to change the name in here. That's not what I want to do. So I want this one to be unavailable in browse mode, so that way when I click this field, I'm actually clicking at the field that's underneath it, the hidden field. But I do want this one to be available in find mode, because if I do a find here, I want to be able to find someone on their full name and not on their ID. So this ID is not available in find mode, but it is available in browse mode. This one is a drop-down list, and this one is just a simple edit box. So this is a trick you're going to be able to use a lot in your FileMaker file. Now one more thing to kind of pay attention to, if I line these up, then we can see that this one field is shorter than the other field, but I have a simple button to make them both the exact same length. So this resize button right here, which will, if you stand on it, I think it gives you a tooltip, resize to largest width. Now these two fields are the exact same size and they're exactly on top of each other. So now if we try this out, I get a drop down. I can choose whichever name I want, and this name shows up, and I don't have to see all of those all those numbers. Now this is no longer a button, so I'm going to make this one kind of the standard color. Let's go here and just choose default. There you go. Okay, so this is kind of working and this is kind of cool. So now I can make a new notes for anyone. So I've got, for instance, Louise Dench, and I've just made a note for her in my notes list. And that is kind of handy, because that way, if I get a phone call from someone and someone says, please send me a letter, then I can just enter it here, and then I can just select for whichever person that this is. And that's a very quick way to be able to make lots of quick notes for multiple different people at the same time. There you go. So now I have a bunch of notes, and now I have these people, but I can't go to those people now because I couldn't turn this into a button. But what I can do is I can just add a button next to it, and then I can use that button. So of course, two ways to make a button. Either just use the button here, maybe I'll just do that because it's simple, or I can just use an image, but I'll just do this one for now. Show details. Okay, that's kind of handy. Let's see. Oops, I do want to kind of make this a button. So I have to do an action, perform script. And oops, no, that's not the action I want to do. I want to do an action, which is a simple single step. Because if you remember, it has to do that same thing as that button just before it did. And that was a go to related record. And we just have to set this up again like we did before. We want to go to our contacts. And we want to see our lay contacts used to display that contact information. We're going to change this to a button. And again, if you have a button and you want it to stand out a bit, you can just make it red or blue, whichever color you like. Now, the height of this field is 22. So let's make our button the same height. It actually already is. And then let's make it a bit smaller, like so. There you go. Now we have a button here. We have the ability to select a person here. We made send me a letter as a note on this person. So let's go and look on their details to see if that actually showed up. Yes, send me a letter has actually shown up here. So now I've got my contacts. I've got my ability to create new contacts, new to-do notes. I can assign them to a contact. And this is kind of pretty handy stuff. Let's say that I've done this, and so this is completed. Then, okay, I get a nice list that is kind of handy. Okay, now, this is a bit of a mess as well, because my completed tasks are also kind of showing up here. And that's not so very handy, because I don't really need to see those anymore. So what I could do is I could do a find. And I could say, show me all the tasks that are incomplete, but I also want to show the tasks that are in progress. So I'm going to do a new find request, and I'm going to say in progress. So find me everything that is incomplete and everything that is in progress. Let's perform that find. And then I'm getting only the tasks that I I'm getting the tasks that are still kind of ongoing. And then if I want, I can sort them by urgency. So urgent. Okay, now the urgent ones are at the bottom, so let's sort them again. Let's sort them in a descending order. Okay, and now the urgent ones are in top, and these are all the to-do tasks that are still in progress. Now, these steps that I just took, doing a find and doing a sort and all of that, these are kind of boring, repetitive tasks that I would have to do kind of every time if I make a new to-do item here. Call soon. This is urgent and incomplete. Let's see if this shows up. No, this doesn't show up. So now I'll have to show that one again. It's here now. Then I'll have to do this find again and the sort again. And that's a lot of stuff that you have to do. And that's a lot of repetitive stuff. I don't like a lot of repetitive stuff because it's just boring. So if there is this repetitive stuff that you have to do, you can automate this stuff. You can just make that all happen as soon as you click this button. Going to this list can filter out all these completed ones and put the urgent ones on top. So I just did that. It's a kind of a double find request and a sort. These are two things that I can just automate in a script. And that script can be run the moment that I hit this button. Because this button has the ability to either do a simple single step or it has the ability to perform a script. Now, scripting might scare you and you might think that it's very complicated, but it's actually very simple. If you're going to make a script, what you need to do is just simply write down all the steps that you need to take, because making a script is simply putting a bunch of steps in a certain order. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to click the contacts button and what happens is I'm going to my layout list to do. That's step number one. Step number two is I'm going to do a find, and I'm going to do a find for the status incomplete, and I'm going to do a new request for the status in progress. I'm going to perform that find. Then I'm going to do a sort by urgent, and it's going to be in descending order. So I'm going to sort that, and then I arrive at the list that I want. Now, all of these steps are my script. That's it. Nothing more, nothing less. So it's very simple. I'm going to go to my script workspace and I'm going to create a new script. Now, I'd like to keep my scripts organized. I'm going to create a new folder, and this is in my menu that this is going to start. So I'll create menu, and the new script is go to do list. So the first one was go to layout. Okay, which layout am I going to go to? Very simple, my list to do. Okay, then what did I do then? I did a find. So I'm going to enter find mode, and I'm going to set my pause to off because I don't want to pause there. I want to straight continue. Then I'm going to do set field. Now, all of these steps are steps that you will learn pretty quick. You're using a lot of steps at the same time, and set field is just basically setting a value into a field. So I'm going to specify the target field. So in my to-do, in my status, I'm going to say I would like everything that is incomplete. Now remember those brackets because you're going to need them. And when I was in my find mode and I set the one to... I set to that first one, then I had to do a new find request. So I'm going to do new... record or request, and this could create a new record, but when I am in find mode it will create a new request. So then I'm going to do another one of these. So I'm going to just copy this one and paste it, drag it down here. So my status also needs to be in progress. That's the second find request that I want to do. Then what I usually like to do is I want to set my error capture on, so that if there is an error, like for instance no to-do tasks are found, I don't want to get like this burp message that shows up, because that gives me stress and my users don't like to get stress. So I like to just make sure that if there is nothing found, I just see an empty list. I don't need an error message for that. So I'm going to set my error capture on, and then I'm going to do a perform find, which is exactly what I did when I was doing that find before. I had to click that perform find button. Then when that is done, I had to do sort. See, it's very simple. These are exactly all the steps that I did before as well. So I'm going to turn my dialog off because I don't want my user at that moment to have to decide how the sort needs to be. I'm going to decide that right now. So I'm going to specify the sort order. And because I am on the layout of my list and I have it sorted already, FileMaker is already suggesting me the current sort order of the list. And I like that one. So I'm going to hit OK. And that's kind of good. Now, if this is a very long list, I might end up somewhere halfway the list, and I don't want that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to record request page first, and I'm going to scroll window home. I'm going to do that so that I always arrive at the top of my to-do list. Okay, let's hit Command S to save this list. And all of this stuff needs to happen when I'm in my menu and I'm clicking this button. So I'm going to change this. I'm going to say, don't do a single step, but perform a script for me. And the script is going to be this go to-do list. Okay, this looks kind of good. Let's try this out. I'm going to click this button. I'm only seeing my incomplete and my in progress to-do items, and all of the urgent ones are in top. Now what I can do is I can show all, and I can see my completed ones as well, but as soon as I go out of the menu and go back in, those completed tasks are gone again. And this will always show me. Now for instance, I'm looking at 6 of 8. If I'm going into my contacts here and I'm making like new if I make a new to-do item here, then I will see that this one actually shows up in my list as well. So visit her tomorrow. I've now got 7 items because that find always happens again every single time I enter this layout. Now, let's take this one step further. Let's say that I've done this and I want to turn this into complete. And let's say I've done this one too, and this one also needs to be made complete. This is kind of good, but they are still kind of showing up here. What I would like is as soon as I set an item as complete, I would like that item to disappear. I don't want it to be deleted, but I just want it to be hidden because I want this list to kind of stay clean, full of only incomplete and in progress tasks. So what I can do, as soon as I change the value of this, and you can kind of try this out, there is this function that you have. For instance, this one is blue now. So this record is selected. I'm on record number 7 of 9. I'm on the 4th of 7 found items, and there are 9 in total. So I'm on number 4. If I move this, you can see that this blue line moves. But this one is a completed one. If I go to records, I have this option to omit a record. And that basically means to omit it from my found set. So I have a found set now of 7 records out of a total of 9. If I omit this one, then this one is going to be hidden, and I will be basically looking at 6 of 9. So let's try this out. Omit record. Okay, so I'm now looking at 6 of 9 records. One record has been omitted. It's no longer in this list, but if I want, I can always get it back. It is still here, but I just omitted it. So what I can do is, as soon as I change the status of an item to completed, then that item can be omitted. That's also a very simple script that I can do, and there's a few things to keep in mind. First of all, this has to happen as soon as I have changed the value in this field. That's the first important thing. Then I have to check what the value is, because I can also change the value to in progress, and then it doesn't have to be hidden. So it needs to check what the value of this field is, and if the value is completed, then I would like to omit that record. So again, a few steps, and again, a situation where we can perfectly use a script. So let's go back to our script workspace, and now we are on our to-do list. So let's make a new folder for this, and let's say to-do list, so that we kind of know where our scripts are. So let's see, omit completed task. Oh, I said tossed. That's not right. Okay, so first thing, this has to happen as soon as I change the value. Okay, that's something I'll have to deal with later. Then I need to check what the value is. So I'm going to do an if statement. And an if statement allows me to kind of create a sort of check. Now, if I hit this FX button, then I get my specify calculation dialog, which is cool because I want to see if my status is completed. If my to-do status is completed, then I want to omit that record. So omit record, omit only one record, so omit record, and if, and that's it. Very simple, little check, omit, and then done. If the status is something else, this will not happen. Let's hit Command S to save. Let's close this again, and there was this first thing that I had to deal with, and that was, this has to happen the moment that I change the value in this field. Now, this needs to happen not as a button, but as a script trigger. And a script trigger is basically, it's what it says. It's going to trigger a script on a certain moment. What that moment is one that you can choose right here. So there are a lot of different events that can happen that can trigger a script. You can trigger a script on object enter. So that is, the script will be run after the selected object, so this field, becomes the active object. Now that's too soon because I need it to happen when I have changed the value. So let's look at what happens here. On object modify, well, that would not work if I'm typing in a field, but this is one where I select a status from a dropdown, so that's kind of a good one. As soon as I have modified the value, my script can be performed. So that's a good one. In this case, let's select and let's do omit completed task, so that script will be run as soon as I've changed this value here. Okay, kind of cool. Let's try this out. So I've got all of these things here. Let's try on one that's already completed. Let's click it, and boom, it's just gone. This one as well, it's completed, so it goes away. This one is in progress, so let's make it completed. Boom. This is incomplete. Let's put it in progress, and this one stays because it hasn't been completed, so it doesn't get moved. Okay. This is another simple addition. It's so simple to set up, but it kind of prevents you from having to do a boring, repetitive task over and over and over again. Otherwise, maybe you'll be setting a bunch of tasks as complete, and then you would be forced to kind of do this and that to kind of get back in there and get the updated list. But now, just the simple changing of the status changes basically the makeup of our list. So it's in tiny little things like this that you can really make your FileMaker file work for you and make it fun and easy and just eliminate as many as possible of the boring repetitive tasks that you would otherwise have to do. Alright, so this was it. Kind of fun little file. We've got our contacts, we've got a lot of information that we can put in there, we've got our to-do list, the map and the website, we can see them in a list view, and we can see all the tasks that we have to do. We can of course start adding tons of different things to this file and really start building it out and adding a lot of different stuff, but I think now I've showed you already the basics, so I hope you guys can get started with this, and then you can start thinking of all of the other things that you can add. If you guys want to learn a ton more about FileMaker, you can head over to my Udemy page where I've got a bunch of entire FileMaker courses online. You can follow them, and basically we make entire FileMaker systems from scratch, and I'll take you on the entire process step by step. There is even one that is completely free, so you can just follow that free of charge, and that is a beginner tutorial where we make an entire contact database. That's a really fun one that you can follow that can teach you the basics of FileMaker. So head over there by following the links in the description, and I'll see you guys there.